for you a little bit. Think about it just as you would when you're on a presentation with a seller, as you would in a presentation with a buyer during either a buyer consultation or an offer consultation. So, kind of weird having this, like,
cool at the same time.
Right, I like it. All right. So what I'm going to do before I get into kind of my notes on the actual presentation, I'm going to share with you the video of me having a pricing discussion. This isn't a live with an actual seller, but it is with two salespeople on our team, or our sales manager and one salesperson, and they're giving me real responses. So this is as real as it could get. So let me see. Does this mouse work?
Yeah, it does.
So we're going to start with just the pricing conversation. And the pricing conversation really is.
Looking forward to going to work for you. Thank you. Do you mind if I take a quick look at your home?
Sure.
It's all right with you. I'd like to take a look at your home through the eyes of the buyer, kind of get a feel for what the home has to offer. While I'm doing that, I'll have.
So this is the actual the entire presentation, but I'm just going to get to the pricing part. Because there's a lot of good takeaways that you'll be able to add to your dialogue.
Right, for buyers. The more buyers that we drive through your home gives us a great range, and they just price it at $525 out of your agent to be recommend the price of $499 on price point. And you're listed at how many bedrooms? Right. So this is what's going on the market, so you can see that. So I brought over three most comparable homes compared to yours. Okay. These homes have all sold in car scenario. Let's say you go back to the first dealership that doesn't have any of the bells and whistles or head spaces. And let's say they reduced the navigation, it's got fancy rims, those are going to point out the features and benefits, and then they're going
All right, so this is where I start talking about pricing.
So let's take a look at what's going on in the market. The purpose of the market analysis, you know, is to determine the value.
And I'm going to pause it at certain points, and I'm going to point out things that you'll want to
buyer determine value.
Yeah,
take a look around. Right? They determine value by comparison shopping. So they're going to take a look at your home, and they're going to point out, the realtor is going to point out the features and benefits, and then they're going to go around the neighborhood or across the street or down the street and look at other homes and compare your features and benefits with those other homes. And then they're going to look at the price and how that compares. Does that make sense?
Yes.
It's kind of like if you were buying a car, right? You go shopping for a vehicle, you go to one dealership, you're in the price range of $40,000, $45,000, and you go to another dealership and they have the same car for the same price, but it's got all the bells and whistles. It's got the navigation, it's got the fancy rims, same price. Which one would you buy?
Obviously, the one with more.
Yeah, the one with more stuff, yeah, right? Yeah. Buyers do the exact same
so
thing. They
this
go
is the
and they
car
on the ones
the
that are priced similar but have more to offer. Mm-hmm. Now, there is one other way that you can get a buyer, okay? Just like you're shopping for cars, go back to the car scenario. Let's say you go back to the first dealership that doesn't have any of the bells and whistles, that has the basics, okay? And let's say they reduce the price of the car from $40,000, you know, it's the end of the month special, they know it's bare bones, and they reduce it down to $30,000, $10,000 off compared to the one that has some bells and whistles. Which one's a better value now?
Well, obviously the one is cheaper.
Yeah, because for $10,000, you could probably get your own stuff if you wanted, right?
Yeah.
Exactly. Buyers respond to real estate and respond to prices the same way we do when we shop for cars. Let me take you a look. Let me take you through exactly what's going on in the market so you can see that.
So
I brought over the three most.
The car analogy, for those that have seen it in the listing presentation, which it's in the bold scripts, it's in the KW scripts, the car analogy is a great way to remove the emotion out of the discussion, right? Because all they want to talk about is why their home is better, or you know, what makes their home great and what they did to it and why the home across the street gave theirs away because they're going through a divorce. And they're talking all emotion, none of which matters to the actual value. And so when you kind of take them out of their house, and let's just pretend you're at a car dealership shopping for a car, you're putting them in the buyer's shoes. And that's why that's powerful, because it's taking them from a state of emotion to a state of logic. Okay, well, yeah, that's right. I guess that's how we would make a decision to do this. So that's, we're trying to show them that buyers that are looking at their home are going to do that the exact same way.
Comparable homes compared to yours, okay? These homes have all sold within the last 6 months. You can take a look at them. Let's start with this one here first. I believe this one is the, let's go to the highest and then we'll go low. Okay, so this was the highest sales price in the neighborhood. This really was a premium home. Everything's been done to it. They had how many bedrooms?
Four.
How many baths?
Three and a half baths.
Yep. And they were built in 2015, right? And look at their square footage.
Wow, 3,600 square feet.
They had a three-car garage. As you can see, they were listed at 525, and look what they sold for.
525, right?
So this one was not only priced right, but it showed well. And this is a perfect example of if you show well, and you've got great marketing, and you're priced right, you can get your asking price. This was the highest sales price in the neighborhood. One of the big things that I noticed in this one is it did have a finished basement. So anytime you have a finished basement, it's gonna add a little bit of value, and I noticed that you guys don't. So we'll have to just keep that in mind, okay?
Okay, so I did two things there that I wanna point out. Number one, when you're going through the pricing, when you're looking at comps and you're showing them things, same thing goes for a buyer. You want them to buy in to what you're saying, so the way that you get them to buy in, and they don't even realize that they're buying in, is just by getting them to answer. So if you actually read the script, it actually tells you everything, make them say everything, okay? So I don't make them say everything word for word as you saw there. I only ask them how many bedrooms, how many bathrooms, and look how long it's been on the market. I'm engaging them versus just telling them. When you're telling, they're not buying in, versus when they're speaking and they're acknowledging, now they're bought into what's taking place. So that's why it may have seemed, and trust me, the first time I was taught to do that, I thought it was a little weird, a little uncomfortable. Like, why am I making them answer? When you make them answer, you're getting their buy-in.
Do you? Other than that, how do you feel that it compares to ours? Do you think ours isn't showing that well?
Yeah, overall, it's pretty comparable. The biggest difference between the two was the finished basement, okay? This is the next highest sale in the neighborhood. They were listed at $542,000, okay? And look what they sold for. 520.
Wow.
How many bedrooms?
Five.
3.5 baths.
Yeah.
Built in 2015, so it's a little newer than yours. Okay, so a newer home, square footage?
3,500.
So a newer home, slightly bigger, sold for 520.
Mm-hmm. No, is it a finished basement or no?
No, this is an unfinished basement.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And you were hoping to get 550?
Yes.
Okay. Let's take a look at this one. How many bedrooms?
Four.
Four.
How many baths?
Three and a half.
Also built in 15.
Mm-hmm.
They were listed at?
495.
And they sold for?
475.
Wow. This one was very similar to yours.
Kind of a range.
Yeah.
They're going anywhere from 475 to 5.25.
Yeah.
This one was probably the most comparable to yours. So based on that, this is the most recent activity in the neighborhood. This is exactly what buyers have said, hey, we love these homes, we're gonna make offers on them. Based on what you see here, what price do you feel we should use to create value in the eyes of the buyer and to get them to buy your home versus the competition?
Well, how long were they on the market?
Well, so this one was actually on the market.
Caught that there. I'm, first of all, doing two things here. Number one, I'm putting it on them, okay? So based on what we've seen, what price do you feel we should use to create value in the eyes of the buyer and to get them to choose your home versus the competition? So I'm doing two things there. Number one, I'm making them tell me something, which by the way, as you know, from being on appointments, they're gonna come back to you and say, well, what do you think? Okay, and sometimes they do, and sometimes they actually do give a number. And I love when they give a number because it gives me an idea of where their head's at. But the other thing I did there, very subtle, in the eyes of the buyer to get them to choose your home versus the competition. So it's just kind of a little subtle hand motion of, in the eyes of the buyer, it's not me, right? It's not you, it's not what you've done to the home, and it's not me, it's the eyes of the buyer to get them to choose your home versus the competition, which I'm pointing to the other ones that are on the market or have sold.
For 37 days, and this one you can see here was on the market for 207 days, and this one was on the market for 94 days. So most of them are sitting a good 3 months right now at this price point. And your goal is to be down in Sarasota this summer, right?
Yeah.
So if you don't want to sit on the market for as long as these homes and you want to be in Sarasota this summer, what price do you feel we should use to create value?
Well, you know, if the market's coming back up, you know, then maybe I think we can still try 550. You know, I don't see why we can't. I mean, you know, 525 is the highest one. I know you said it has a finished basement, but.
Gets us that money and you can do what we want to do, and that's kind of what we're looking.
Yeah, there's certainly trying a higher price and coming down later is always an option. And what concerns me about that is when buyers are looking at homes, one of the number one things they're looking at, and you already asked the question, is how long has it been on the market? And what we find is that the longer a home is on the market, the less a home is actually worth. So what we prefer to do is put it at a price that we believe it'll sell for and hold firm at that price. Now, based on what's going on in the market, I'm going to recommend a price of $499. Will you list your home with me for that price tonight?
I don't know. I don't want to give our house away. We want to move. You know, we definitely need the money out of the house, you know, so I'm not sure.
We're kind of using this as kind of a way to kind of decide what it is we're going to do next. Is that kind of fit into those numbers that we need to do?
And I know ultimately you need the amount to go down to Sarasota, and I'm sure you've got money set aside as well for that move, because that's a pretty big move moving across country like that. But ultimately, it's my job as your agent to be upfront and honest with you about what's going on in the market. And the mistake that most sellers make is they spend their time in fantasy land, they sit on the market only to have to reduce.
It's my job to be upfront and honest with you about price, okay? That is one of the most powerful things that you can say and you should say in almost every single presentation. Because what happens is, as you know, 9 times out of 10, we're going to have a little bit of a back and forth on pricing and an understanding on pricing. So they need to know that I'm coming from a position of not arguing with them, but doing my job and being upfront and honest with them about the price. You don't want to hire a weak agent who's just going to come in here and list it at any price you want and then have it sit on the market, which was the other script that was in there. Just the longer the home's on the market, the less it's worth. That should be part of everyone's dialogue.
Later. I mean, one of these homes you saw in there went from $540,000 down to $520,000, and they sat on the market for 97 days. So what if that seller knew that they were going to get $520,000 and they just priced it at $525,000 and only had to sit on the market for a week or two? Don't you think it'd be a little bit less stressful and they'd be a little bit happier of a seller?
Yeah.
See, my job as your agent to put you in that type of a situation. The longer your home is on the market, the less it's worth. And at the end of the day, I'd rather price it to sell and perhaps get you into a multiple offer situation. Now, we can't guarantee it, but it's still happening in the market. Are you familiar with multiple offer situations?
I didn't think they existed too much anymore.
Well, they were more common when it was the peak of the seller's market, but they're still taking place. When a home is priced right, shows right, and is marketed properly, you could definitely get into a multiple offer situation. And a perfect example is, on a 499 house, we have it happen all the time, where we get a seller 505 or even 515 for the house, because it falls right under that $500,000 level price point. And a home that's just listed under 500, you're now opening it up to all those buyers that are searching between 4 and 500. You see, in the area where your home is located, the most popular search price point is 350 to 500. So if you're a dollar over 500,000, your buyer pool goes from this size down to this size. And ultimately, you want to fish in the biggest pond, right? For buyers, right? The more buyers that we drive through your home gives us a greater chance of ultimately getting it sold, right?
So that's the price. We call it the price bracket script, which means if you're ever close to getting into a lower bracket, you convince them to get into a lower bracket because of the extra exposure it's going to give. So if someone tells you, well, we were really thinking, you know, 215,000. Well, no. We need to get to 199.9 because you need to get below 200 because everyone searches from 100 to 200. And if you're below 200, we have a greater chance of getting into a multiple offer situation. We could still end up with 215 or 205 or 210. We don't, you know, once it's out there and it's below 200, that's what's going to drive more of the traffic. So using the price brackets whenever you're kind of on the fringe, and obviously you can do the same thing, you know, a seller wanted to list just yesterday at 239.9. Well, we convinced that seller to get down to 2.25 because it's going to get more exposure at 225 than it will at 239.9. At 239.9, you're now competing with the sellers that are close to 250,000 or slightly above.
In order to drive more traffic and to get more buyers, we need to have a more attractive price. And I think 499 is going to get us plenty of interest, hopefully multiple offers, and ultimately drive the value up over the asking price. That is what you want, isn't it?
Oh, definitely what you want. I think the most
I mean, my concern is that buyers always come in lower, so should I price it high with the idea that I've got negotiating room?
Mike, you know, I know this may sound a little bit backwards, but I'd rather price it at $499 and hold firm at that price than price it any higher than that, because you can always tell a buyer no, and you can always tell a buyer to come back if it's still on the market. The reality is it's not going to be on the market when you price it right. The mistake that most sellers make is they price it high, and then they reduce later, and then they lose all their leverage. Are you familiar with how leverage works in your favor right now?
A leverage discussion.
No. See, when you have leverage, more buyers are attracted to your property because it's new to the market and it's aggressively marketed. Those are the properties that end up getting into multiple offer situations. I know this sounds backwards, but you have a better chance of getting $510 or $515 for your home by pricing it at $499 than you do by pricing it at $525.
So you're pretty confident we could get $510 for this house?
Well, we don't know until we put it out there and see how the buyers respond. Ultimately, the market is fluid. Prices go up and they go down based on what's taking place in the market.
That's called the disclaimer. So when they pin you down to a number, you can say something that makes them feel comfortable. Well, yeah, I think that's the right number. The reality is, we don't know until we put it out there and see how the buyers respond. And prices are fluid based on what's taking place in the market. Prices can go up if you know, we have low inventory, or a neighbor lists for sale and they're $50,000 higher than you, or something sells for more that's similar to you, and they can go down based on inventory coming on the market or someone showing better but being at the same price. You're always kind of putting a disclaimer of, you don't know until you put it out there and see how the buyers respond to it.
If another one of your neighbors lists and they say, hey, we've got to beat them out and undercut them, well, then that could change our value. Or if another, now that's one way it could go down. One way it could go up is if another home in your neighborhood sells for more. And then all of a sudden it drives people to your property because they see that homes are actually selling for more. And that's how you get into a multiple offer.
So what do you think we could sell that we'll actually walk away
from? Ultimately, if we're going to price it at $499, which I'm sure you hear our stats, we average our sellers 98% of their asking price. My goal is to get you somewhere in the high 490s. Could sell for $499, and it might even sell for more, but ultimately I think we're going to be in the high 490s.
And what would we net then? I mean, what's your commission? You know, that's another concern too.
Yeah. Well, I'll get into,
you know, now we just dropped $50,000 off what we're
thinking. Yeah, absolutely. So I'll get into the costs and everything at the end, but we have to determine the right price, because at the end of the day, it doesn't matter how good of a salesperson I am, it doesn't matter how much we spend on marketing, if we're not the right price, then we're not going to be able to drive traffic. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, that's what you want. The home that gets the most showings gets the most offers.
So what they did there, they tried to take me off track, and that happens a lot, obviously, on presentations. Okay, we understand, yeah. What is this gonna cost? Or what are you gonna do to sell my home? Or how long is your contract? Or, you know, do we have to have a lock? You know, they just kind of say things to get you off track. What you'll notice, and in every presentation I do this, because it'll be a 2-hour presentation if you let them control it, because they just want to talk and talk and listen and talk and go back and forth, and now you're bouncing around and you forgot what you were talking about 20 minutes ago. I like to keep them on track without being rude and saying, nope, we can't talk about that. But what I did right there was a little bit of deflection. Perfect. Great question. You want to know what we charge? That's going to be something we're going to talk about in just a bit. But let's make sure we get this down first, okay? So I'm bringing them back to this before I move on to the next discussion. The same thing goes, and I think they're going to ask, well, what are you going to do to sell our home? I'm not going to get into any of that until I have a commitment on this, because that takes more time, more distractions come up, more questions. They take you off track, and you have no commitment from them. And then you leave the house without a contract signed, and they're confused.
And how do you drive traffic, since you brought that up?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So one of the things that we do to drive traffic to our listings is we look at marketing in two separate lights, right? So before I get into the marketing, I just want to make sure that we've got a confirmation that you're reasonably, you know, thinking that $499 could be the price to get it sold. Is that?
Yeah, I mean, it's a little less than we wanted, but I think if you can show us a plan, that's the number we're going to get, and we can start looking at things and going, okay, this is what we can do,
yeah,
and where we're at, then that's great. If it's going to be something that's going to be a lot less than that, then we have to revisit,
yeah,
if we're even going to go to Sarasota.
Well, one of the things you need to consider, and this is the part that I hate about the business, and that is we could find a great buyer for your property, and they come in and they love it, and they're going to give us multiple offers, and we end up selling it for $515. In almost every purchase agreement, there's a clause, and it's called contingency on appraisal. And that means no matter what a buyer says they'll pay for your house, if their lender doesn't believe that it's worth what they're willing to spend, then the lender will come back and say, you know what, the deal is denied, the transaction's been denied, unless the buyer pays the difference. Well, put yourself in the shoes of the buyers. How comfortable will you be paying more than appraised value on the home that you're purchasing down in Sarasota?
Yeah.
Probably not very comfortable, yeah. Right? Somebody's telling you, hey, I know you agreed to buy it for $500,000, but it appraised for $485,000, so you're gonna have to pay $15,000 over appraisal. Are you okay with that? Of course you wouldn't be.
Yeah.
Well, unfortunately, that's one of the realities of the market right now. And the appraisers, these are what they're looking at, right? So they're gonna take a look at that, these three comparables that we've looked at already, and they're gonna do exactly what we did. They're gonna compare the bedrooms, the bathrooms, the age, the square footage, the basement, whether it's finished or not. They're gonna do it exactly the way we did, and then they're going to place a price on your home. So if you were doing an appraisal, and you're seeing numbers of 520, 525, 475, don't you think it'd be hard to justify an extra $25,000 or $50,000 over everything else that's going on?
Yeah,
it's true.
But I'm looking at the two, those are closings, and there's really not much active. If we're the only one out there,
yeah,
can we help drive things up since there's very little room?
Yeah.
But that's kind of what I'm saying.
And you
on.
Could, and you're absolutely right. When there's not a lot of competition, it's possible that homes could sell for more than the ones that have closed. The key is, we have to find a buyer that's willing to pay over appraised value.
Yeah, makes sense.
That's not going to be easy, right? Because
what
buyers are, yeah, if we get multiple offers, then we have leverage. And we'll never get into multiple offers unless we price it right. Because an attractive price on an attractive home, marketed properly, can get in multiple offers. But you can have a great home and all the marketing in the world with a price that's just average, and it's not really drawing a lot of people in. You see, we need a price that's going to draw them in. And that's how you get into a multiple offer situation. And of course, we can't guarantee that. The reality is, nobody knows the value of the home. Forget everything we just talked about. Nobody knows the value of the home until we put it on the market and see how buyers respond to it. That's when we'll determine the value of the home. Mm-hmm. Make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So based on that, would you be comfortable with the strategy of listing it at $499,900 with a goal to get $499,900 or very close to it?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if I'd say I'm comfortable, but I understand, and it looks like the numbers are telling us what we have to do. You know, it's not exactly what we wanted to do.
Right,
but
agree.
I think if we could feel confident that you could deliver that number really at the high end of it, mm-hmm. I think we'd find a little easier way to sleep at night.
If it meant the difference of getting to Sarasota or not, would you do it?
Yeah.
Came down there.
Yeah.
Right? Want to get there.
And the reason why I ask that is because a lot of sellers say, well, okay, I agree, you know, 500 is probably the price, but can we at least try 525? Well, the reality is that if 525 doesn't work and we go to reduce it 2 weeks from now, 4 weeks from now, now the listing starts to become stale. And how can we possibly attract new buyers and get the buyers excited about a home that's already been on the market for 30 days? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's why it's important that you put it at the right price right out of the gate. Fair enough. And I know, again, I know it sounds backwards, but you've got a better chance of getting $10,000 or $15,000 over asking by pricing it at $499,900 than you do by pricing it at $515,000. I mean, it's simple economics. If you look at most of the internet sites out there, Zillow, Trulia, Realtor.com, even the multiple listing service that agents use to search, they go in increments of $25,000 to $50,000 at a time. Right? So in your particular neighborhood, buyers are searching between $400,000 and $500,000, or between $350,000 and $500,000. If you're a dollar over $500,000, 501, 505, you may not even show up in their search.
Right.
And that goes back to the opening up the buyer pool versus shrinking it. Make sense?
It does.
So $499,900. What other questions do you have for me?
Well, you said you're gonna talk about commission, you know, I just wanna understand what our net would be.
Perfect.
Really, how we're gonna get the $499,900, what are you gonna do differently?
Gotcha, so you wanna know what it's gonna cost and what your net will be at the end of the transaction and what we're going to do to sell it.
Mm-hmm.
Great, so far, do you feel that I can sell your home?
Yeah.
I think we feel pretty confident. I don't think we would have had you sit at our table if we didn't feel that you were worth talking to.
Okay, good, well, I appreciate that. So, we get asked all the time, you know.
Okay, so, today, I just wanted to show kind of the pricing conversation because when you look at the entire listing presentation from start to finish, I know for a fact, especially for us, we look at our stuff, the listings are won and lost on that discussion. Because if they're interviewing top agents and agents are just going in there and they're just kind of winging it, going through, well, what do you think? Yeah, this makes sense. Oh, this is one sold, you know. They're not respecting that type of a conversation, okay? okay? So if you're up against top agents may go in and say, just like this, or step by step, walking them through, or being strong on price, or using dialogue, or educating them on appraisals. All of those conversations need to take place at the listing presentation in order for you to not only get a great listing at a great price, but for them to feel comfortable with your strategy. Because if they don't feel comfortable with the pricing strategy, and I know if you've been on a lot of listing presentations, you've had people say, and it's great, it feels like, wow, I really did my job when they say this. Well, you know what's funny? The last agent said that they wanted a price at $25,000 higher than you're suggesting, and we don't think it's worth it. And they list with you at a lower price because you do such a good job of presenting the price. So if you look at your current presentation, how much time, effort, energy are you putting into that kind of a conversation? And same thing goes to when you're doing a buyer consultation. There's a lot of those things that you could pull out of that that you could use in your buyer consultation or you could use in your offer consultation to educate them on what's happening in the market and how sellers are pricing homes and how that affects them. But if you look at every single part of the presentation from the introduction, you know, introduction to walking through their house to presenting what you're going to do for them, this is by far the most important part of the listing presentation, the pricing conversation. So before I move on to some additional thoughts I have on perfecting the listing presentation, what are some of your ahas, thoughts, questions, things that you saw that you were like surprised I did or said, or anything that in there that you want some clarification on? Or anything that you noticed, or anything that you watched and said, holy crap, I'm not doing that. Or I need to do more of that. Or I need to change this.
Well, I like that you're very repetitive as far as repeating the same things to really hone in on those facts to get it in through to them, because yeah. They get stuck on their numbers.
Yep.
Generally, do you actually show them just the top three? Like,
yeah.
Do you compare? Okay.
Yeah, I don't want to sit there and go through, you know, 15 solds and 15 actives.
Okay.
I'm taking, you know, 5 or 6 or 7 out, and when I get to the house, I'm looking through and figuring out the best three that I'm going to show them. And sometimes I'm doing it when they're not even noticing. So I might start with 6 or 7 because I don't know what the inside of their house has or what it looks like. And as I'm going through some questions with them, I'm actually like pulling a few out, flipping them over, pulling them out, flipping them over, and just grabbing the three that I think are most comparable.
Okay.
Because it confuses them. Anything over 3. I mean, you could probably go up to 5, but
yeah.
There's no need to sit here and go through one and then another and then
it
another.
It's tedious.
According to the bold scripts, it's you basically show them one that's better than theirs, one that's worse than theirs, and one that's perfectly fit for theirs. That's ideally. But I know it doesn't always work that way. The moral of the story is keep it less than 5.
Okay.
Do you ever ask them how they came up with the idea that they want for price? Because if they have it.
Yeah, that's a good, yep.
Usually get out of it.
Yeah, no, that's actually a good one. So for whatever reason, it didn't go down that path, but yeah, that is actually in the bold scripts. Specifically, hey, help me justify. I'm cool with wanting to get you more money. If we can get you 5 1/4, let's do it. Specifically, why do you feel your home is worth more than your neighbors? What have you done differently? Let's collectively talk this out together. What I find, though, the only downside of doing that is number one, it just opens up more discussions for not necessarily an argument, but now they're selling you on why their home is worth more. And good, bad, right, or wrong, salespeople like to be sold. So we take the listing a little bit higher because we buy into what they're telling us, and then we have a listing that's sitting on the market and not selling. So that would be the only kind of caution I would say on that. But it is a good line when someone is so adamant about it being worth more than everyone.
What I've been finding is, I ask them, well, is there a house in the neighborhood that you base it on? And a lot of times, there is.
Yep.
Somebody down the street.
Yep.
And I'll ask them, do you happen to know the address? And if they do, which they usually do, I'll pull it up on the iPad.
Yep.
And I'll go through the pictures. Yeah, you're right. Your house is very similar. So would you be happy selling for the same price as them? And they'll say, yeah, we would. And I'll say, okay, well, you know, there's sold for this much per square foot. So
yep.
Let's multiply that by your square footage.
Mm-hmm.
Which is putting you right where I wanted to price you. So it looks
yeah.
like we're on the same page.
Yeah, and that's the thing. You kind of have to know in advance because you need to know that that's going to work out in your favor.
Mm-hmm.
But another way that you could add to that is if you notice something that, you know, I gave the example here of a finished basement versus not having a finished basement.
Mm-hmm.
You're right, they did sell for more, but if in your case, the iPad, did you see their, you see this finished basement? Holy crap, this is why it's sold, right? So,
mm-hmm.
No, that's a good angle to take. What else?
wouldn't it be okay to start higher sometimes? Because usually when you keep dropping the price, usually when you hit the sweet spot, you start getting the offers right away. And then people think, well, I got a better deal because you dropped the price. Then you're making your seller happy too.
Yeah, I mean, here's the deal. At the end of the day, with inventories being so low, okay, yes, there is a chance that you can take a listing over price and you get a reduced and it's going to sell. I'm not debating that. What I would debate on that is that that's not in the best interest of them. Because what's in the best interest of them is entering the market at the right price and getting them into a multiple offer situation. Because even when that does happen, and we've all had it happen, all of a sudden we have a listing that we've had for like 37 days and we've got nothing, and then all of a sudden there's four offers. How is this even possible, right? We just had it up, right? And usually it's after a reduction or something like that. The leverage is the highest at the beginning point. And the leverage is important because that's when you're gonna get buyers to do crazy things like waiving inspections and paying overpriced value. And you know, 37 days into a listing, it's harder for you to get that. That's why. And generally speaking, they always want more than what it's worth. So I'd rather go in a little bit less, even if I did give in. Here, I didn't give in. But trust me, there's times when I give in. Even when I give in, we're meeting in the middle. So we're meeting somewhere where they were versus where I am, and in the middle is still better than where they wanted, right? So that does sometimes happen. And if you do take a listing overpriced, which these are one of my notes, if you do take a listing overpriced, then you get a commitment up front at the time of listing that if this price doesn't work, we're going to have to adjust it.
That's what I was gonna say, as long as they agree to keep on dropping it until it sells.
Yeah, as long as you get a commitment up front, you don't need to, we have a, and if you don't have this, I would encourage you to do this in our listing packet. We have a pre-price reduction form. In fact, it was, I think we took it out because the last couple of years we haven't needed it, but it's a pre-price reduction form. And it basically says that at this time, you know, at these days and times, if the home doesn't sell, in order to continue to be an attractive listing, it's got some verbiage that sells it or whatever, to be, you know, you have all these dates and then future price reductions. So what we used to do when we needed it, so whenever you need it, I would encourage you to use it, is we wouldn't necessarily put a date in there, but we put to be determined. And then we put a price, to be determined. We put a couple prices down just so they know we're not gonna go from 225 down to 222. We're gonna go from 225 to 215. And if that doesn't work, we're gonna go to 200, right? So you're prepping them for those reductions at the time of listing.
Could you email that to me so I can fix it up and get it out?
Yeah, pre-price reduction form. Yep, I can do that. What else before we move on?
At what time do you decide just to walk away?
Yeah, good question. So what time do you decide to walk away? I look at motivation above all, okay? So a lot of times people say, well, okay, this is great. They owe nothing on it. You know, this is gonna be an easy one. And they want, you know, the largest number in the world and it's never gonna happen. Well, they're not that motivated. I would take someone who's upside down and motivated over someone that has all the ability in the world but low motivation. So I think it's gonna be a case-by-case basis, but if you're just talking price, I would say if you're more than 15 to 20% off, you're definitely not taking that listing. I mean, if I'm on an appointment and I know that 200 is the number, I'll take it at 2 1/4, 220.
I'll say I wanted to ask.
Yeah, but I won't take it at 250. My response is, it's my job to be upfront and honest with you, Sean, and at this price, I'd be doing you a disservice if I took your listing. Yeah. So you just turn it up. Why do you want to assign it? First of all, the whole crap about, well, take listings and we'll get buyer calls. You don't get buyer calls on overpriced listings, okay? Why do you think the ones that are priced right get all the action and all the activity and all of the leads, you know, right in the beginning? Because they're priced right. You don't get leads off of those. So don't take overpriced listing. It's a disservice to you. It hurts your stats. You know, one of the stats I gave is that we average our sellers 98% of their asking price. You should know what your number is. And it's pretty easy to figure out. You know, go back and figure out. We've got broker metrics. We can type in your name and tell you. What else on this? The pricing discussion, pricing presentation. Anything at all? Any other questions, thoughts? Cool. Go ahead.
As far as obviously the comps you're using are just closed. That's all you use. We talked about, I normally always bring the competition, I always bring active listings, and always bring pending.
Obviously
you're speeding things up, I get it, but is there something else?
No, there's no logic behind the reason why I didn't use any actives or pendings in there. And sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. It just depends on where it's at, how close they are to the neighbor, you know, whether to the subject property, whether it's going to help my pricing presentation or not. Usually the solds help your pricing presentation because they're the lowest.
Yeah.
Okay. The actives are going to say, well, so-and-so is listed for whatever. Why can't we list at their price? Well, I don't really want them to focus on that too much. So I focus more on the solds because it kind of revolves around, again, going back to the appraisal discussion. That appraisal discussion is happening in every single pricing presentation because it's taking it off of me and putting it onto someone else on the appraiser. Yeah.
Well, and with that, the solds are the ones that matter because so active, you could have 5 actives all over price. It doesn't mean they'll actually sell. They could expire.
Right. Yeah.
So.
Well, he's coming from a standpoint of if I can point out to them that we can be the best priced home on the market by doing this. And those help with that, then I love it.
And then the days on market too, you can say, yeah, we can price
show
it here,
on market.
But
yeah.
Yep. And pendings are good too, because pendings, you can say, this is what a buyer just put an offer on, like it just happened, right? So
yeah, when they see the pending, a lot of times it's overpriced, they think it's gonna be sold for that price though.
Yeah, that's
they're going to pending at like 200 when they're going to pay 175.
So you just tell them, hey, just like I'm telling you, it could have sold for more than asking. Could have sold for 10% less.
Most times not though.
We don't know. Right. Yeah, exactly. All right. So if you have other thoughts or questions as we go through this, bring them up. I'm going to go through spend the last 15 minutes or so talking about just some more points on listing presentations. So one of the first things on here, which is obviously something that I did here, but it's also something that we do with our people, and that is have someone record your listing presentation. Just like I did to two agents in the office, grab two agents in the office and say, okay, we're gonna tape this, you're gonna present, okay? Have someone tape your listing presentation, and when you're done with that, take it home, turn off all the lights, lock yourself in a room, okay? Don't let anyone see it, okay? Because you might not like what you see, and just study it, okay? And look at where you're good, look at where you need some work, and that's what's gonna help you get better. We do a process that we take our people through where we make them write out the presentation from start to finish, role play it, videotape it. The videotaping is kind of like the final exam. Next thing I wrote down, which I do all the time, it is not common to ask sellers why they didn't list with you, but always make sure you do whenever you don't get a listing. Always call the seller and say, if you don't mind me asking, I understand you're going in a different direction. What caused you to make that decision? What was it that pushed you in that direction? What did they offer that was different than what we were doing? And come from a position of, I need your help. And that's what I'll say. You know, it usually happens on the same call, right? And of course, they love leaving voicemails or sending you a text or an email. They don't want to tell you that they're not listening with you. They want to just like slip it in somehow. So I get the message or I get an email that they went with someone else and I'm calling them. Hey, just got your message. I appreciate you letting me know and I appreciate the opportunity. I'm always looking for ways to improve our process, and I could use your help. If you don't mind me asking, what was it that made you or caused you to decide to go in a different direction? Every time I lose a listing, without question, I'm making that call. And of course, I'm ending it on a positive note. Appreciate the opportunity. If things don't work out, I'll be here for you. Okay? You'll learn a lot from that, and you know, you'll go through different phases in your business depending on what your strengths and weaknesses are. And you know, they'll tell you. Some of them will be brutally honest with you, and it's great feedback. You know, it might bother you for a minute, but it's going to help you get over it and get to the next level. I have written down here, always follow the 5-step listing process. So I'll share with you our listing process now. Number one, we talked about this in the last session or 2 sessions ago. Pre-qualify 100% of the people you present to, no exceptions. You're never going on a listing presentation blind. There's a list of questions, they're there for a reason. What I say makes sense, and you feel comfortable and confident. You guys should remember that from the last one. Ask all the questions on the script. You'll gain more information, so you'll have more power when you get there. Number 2, send them, whether it's digitally, physically, you know, snail mail, UPS, send them some sort of listing package, pre-listing package, okay? Look at it like this. If you're going on an appointment, okay, and most cases, as we know, unless we're always only meeting with our friends, which, you know my take on that. There's 2 types of people in this world. People we know, people we don't know. Which group is bigger? The people you don't know. If you only work with friends, your business is going to be limited. You have to have a balance of both. Friends are great, and it's great to get referrals from friends, but you want to get comfortable with working with strangers if you want to grow a big business. So since a lot of our business should be coming from people we don't know, we have to send them something in advance to get them excited about the appointment. And if we're, if they're interviewing two or three people, there's a good chance that the other agents that they're meeting with aren't doing this. Okay, so when I send them a pre-listing package, make sure you have the following in this pre-listing package. Some sort of list of either references or customer surveys or reviews. We send out Zillow reviews. So after every closing, we send all of our clients to Zillow to leave a review on us. When we go on a presentation, we email them a copy of our pre-listing package, and in it is all of the Zillow reviews. Now, if you have a list of references, that's fine too. Something showing that people have used your services and like working with you. Next, your plan of action. Everyone should have what they're doing from start to finish to sell the house. Whether it's one page or 50 pages, ours is a simple one-page form, which, you know, if we get into it later, I go through the plan of action in the rest of the presentation, but everyone should have their own plan of action. Some sort of copy of the track record or the company's track record. So when I first started the business, you know, I was 19 years old, I didn't own a home. I started with Century 21 and they were powerful at the time, so I just promoted the heck out of that. Well, fortunately, we're with the number one franchise in the United States, and we happen to have Keller Williams like the first or second largest market share in all of Southeast Michigan. So depending on your track record, or if you're newer, then you promote your team or you promote the company. If you've got a great track record, well, then you promote your track record. Next, you want to put in there a completed market analysis with the prices circled and things highlighted. So you're sending them this stuff in advance. So they're seeing the comps before you even get there. Why do we do that? So there's less arguments and discussions around price like we had at the home in this video. You're prepping them for what you're going to show them. Copy of your contract. Might as well get that out of the way. You're going to be asking them to sign one anyways. Send them a copy of the agreement so they know exactly what they're going to be signing in advance. Seller's disclosure statement. Send those in advance. Why would we send those? Well, number one, I don't want to sit at the table for 20 minutes while they ask me how to answer whether they've had water in their basement or not. Okay? I want to put a little sticky note or a note on there that says, please fill out and sign prior to our appointment, so I can know exactly what's went on with the house or what's going on with the house. And if for whatever reason they don't fill that out, because sometimes that happens, I never, now of course, our system is set up in a way where we have a photographer go out and put on a lockbox and so forth. So we have someone that's going back to the house. Depending on where the listing is, you're going to make your determination on this. But my mindset is, I don't want to sit there while they're filling that form out. First of all, it takes 20 minutes, and then they're going to ask you for your advice, which we're not supposed to give them advice. So I'm trying to get that filled out in advance before I get there. So we pre-qualify 100%. We mail them the pre-listing package, or we send it to them, or we email it to them. Next, we call back to remind them of the appointment and ask if they received the pre-listing package. We call back and remind them of the appointment. Some of this stuff sounds so basic and so simple, but I'm telling you, it goes a long way. People appreciate that. If they need to reschedule, that would be an opportunity for them to do so. You know, if they're not gonna be there, we've all been, you know, porched, as we call it. You know, we get to the door and they're not there. This helps with that, okay? Next, we show up physically and mentally and emotionally. Remember, it's showtime. That is our mantra when we go on a listing presentation. It's like we're walking from behind the curtain onto the stage when we get into that house. And, you know, it's probably more natural for me now than it was when I first started, but when you sit and watch a lot of that, it probably felt or seemed a little showy. That's because when I'm on a presentation, it's showtime. That's how I feel. Obviously, it's going to be a little bit different presentation if you're always meeting with friends. Your presentation may not go the same. And then finally, follow the scripts. Read them if you have to. Always have a copy handy, have a copy with you. Which, you know, that when I talk about the scripts, we're talking about the bold scripts or the Mike Ferry scripts, which are basically virtually the same. So what you saw here was a portion of the scripts, right? A lot of that dialogue is in the scripts. How I presented the comps are part of the scripts. A lot of it is also custom to the discussion. Right, so you're going to get off track and you're going to get off the script sometimes. That just happens. Did you have a question?
No.
Okay. Interesting. Mike puts in here. These are a combination of my notes from like Mike Ferry, Floyd Wickman, stuff that I've learned. Mike has. I didn't write this one, but Mike has in here. If you think these five steps don't apply to you, your ego is in the way. Okay. Next, create a pre-appointment routine. Very crucial to a listing presentation. Probably one of the more favorite things for me to do, because when I'm showing up, remember, it's showtime. It's like, okay, put the best trained salespeople on this kitchen table. And my mindset is, it's showtime, I'm gonna smoke them. And because I have that mindset, it forces me to study and master and get better and videotape and study and master and get better. So I have a pre-listing appointment routine, which includes, number one, getting your mindset in order. Whatever you gotta do to get your mindset right before you get there. We have a saying that says, flip the switch at the door. Doesn't matter what happened on your way over, doesn't matter what happened at the office, doesn't matter what happened at the home, you flip the switch at the door. When you walk through their house, it's like, you know, opening the gates of heaven. Like, okay, everything's great, let's do this, right? We're gonna rock and roll. How do you get your mindset in order? Well, there's a lot of things you can do. You listen to positive audio in the car. You know, I used to have a little thing where I would listen to that song by the OJs, the Money, Money, Money song, that always like got me pumped up. Just something to get your mindset right. Okay, obviously looking and dressing professionally, we all know that. Understanding the comps before you get there. Okay, so you don't have to sit at a computer for 45 minutes at the office and stare at the comps, but at least review them, because it might have been a while since you've prepped for that. You might have prepped in the morning and you've had a closing, you've had some stuff happen, you've had some things fall apart, and you get there and you're frantic. Stop and take a second while you're in the driveway, pull out the comps. This is probably the time when you pull up, you know, narrow it down from 7 to 6 or, you know, 6 to 3 or whatever, and just refresh your memory on what you're walking into. Always have the materials prepared and obviously be on time. Remember that first impressions are critical. This includes everything from the clothes you wear, how well you're groomed, if your shoes are shine, the smile on your face, the strength of your handshake. Think about upgrading everything. The more you upgrade, you'll notice a correlation between the more you upgrade and your price point. Okay? You'll notice that correlation when you start upgrading things. Next. Huge point on listing presentations, and you didn't necessarily see a lot of it here because we were more so educating on price, but if you watch the first half or the back half, you see a lot of it in the beginning. A sales presentation is asking great questions, not telling them what you think. Sales presentation is asking great questions, not telling them what you think. It's very easy for us to get all telly. We're experts, we study this stuff, we know the market. Okay? Telling is not selling. Asking questions is selling. And it takes time, takes practice. You have to turn some of your statements into questions, or there's times when you want to just blurt out the answer or say something that you think is appropriate or, you know, right for the moment, but you really want them to understand it. How do you get them to understand it? You ask them questions to buy in. You get them to answer, like I was doing in the video there. You get their buy-in that way. Next, have a strong knowledge of the MLS stats. So don't just know what's going on in their neighborhood, but make sure you know, hey, in all St. Clair Shores, we've got 37 homes on the market. The average days on the market is 63 days. Know some of that stuff when you get there. The analyticals especially will appreciate that. You know, the expressos and the drivers, you'll bore them to death with that kind of information, so you'll have to make a determination whether you need to share that or not. But if you have that knowledge, you have it handy, you have it with you, you're going to be better prepared when it's appropriate. So having the knowledge of the MLS stats will set you apart from the competition. Just like you saw there, and I repeated over and over, let the seller know that you and they don't set the price. The market does. This removes the blame from you when you go ask for a price reduction. Because if you tell them you're confident, if you've listed this price, we're gonna get it done, and you have to go back and get a price reduction, it's your fault. You picked the wrong price. You gave us the wrong price. That's why I showed, you know, that I put that disclaimer in there. We don't know until we put it on the market and see how buyers respond. Next. Huge point. I feel like I keep saying that a lot. Those are like a lot of them. This is a big one. Motivated sellers want a motivated, aggressive agent. Unmotivated sellers want unmotivated agents. So if you feel at any point in time in your presentation, or after watching that, or after you practice your scripts, this is a little strong, this isn't comfortable, this isn't me, okay? Those are all normal emotions and normal feelings to go through. Motivated sellers want that. Motivated sellers want a salesperson. Motivated sellers want someone who's proactive. They want someone who's a bit on the aggressive side. If you offend people or turn people off by being too motivated or too strong with your scripts, then they're probably not that motivated. They're gonna list with an agent who's gonna tell them what they wanna hear, who's gonna take it at whatever price that they suggest, and will basically just kind of be at their beck and call. They don't want an unmotivated seller doesn't want an agent to take control. Why? Because you could probably actually sell their house. And a lot of people aren't necessarily sure whether they wanna sell their house or not, they're just testing the water. So don't ever be afraid to be more motivated than what is comfortable, to be more aggressive than what's comfortable. That's what the scripts are for. Have the attitude that you're not leaving the home until you have a contract signed. Have the attitude that you're not leaving the home until you have a contract signed. We've all been there, okay? I don't care how great you think the presentation went. There's a million things that can happen between your appointment on Tuesday at 6 o'clock and Thursday at 4 o'clock. By the time they talk to someone else, they talk to someone in the family, you're following up with them 2 days later, are you ready to put me to work for you? Oh, we listed with another agent. We had a great presentation, how did that happen? There's all sorts of things that come up in the process of, if you're meeting with sellers, trust me when I tell you, they're meeting with other people, they're calling other people, they're telling other people they're interviewing agents, they're getting referrals from other people. My mindset is, if I'm walking out of that door without a contract signed, I just dropped my chance of getting that listing by 50%. So if I had a 90% chance of getting the listing, I'm down to like 40. And it's a bonus to me if they come back, if they still want to list with me later. That's my mindset. So because I look at it that way, I'm going to do everything I can to try to get it signed right there on the spot. Which, you know, we'll go through later in sessions on closing properly and asking for the signatures and so forth. But I know that if they're a motivated seller, I know they're talking to others, and I know that if I walk out of there without a contract signed, there's a chance that somebody else could get it. That's my attitude. Okay, so for the respect of everyone's time, it's 4:30. It's actually 4:34, but if you have questions on anything that we've discussed on listings, I'll be happy to stick around for a few minutes and answer them. Anything at all on the listing process, the listing presentation, anything at all?
With your pre-listing packet, you said you normally email everything?
Yes, we would prefer
okay.
to mail it or FedEx it because it's more powerful in hand physically.
Okay.
But if we don't do that, we get something out to them by email.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. And that the callback to remind is calling back to remind them to open it and check their email and ask them if they received it as well.
Okay. And then the listing contract, you pretty much have everything filled out and the contract's what they see as far as a commission.
Yes, everything filled out ahead of time because I want them to give me the objection. Well, I saw your contract and it said you guys charge 7%. Well, what's this about? Great question. Glad you brought that up. It sounds like you've met with a few agents that charge less. Yeah, they're offering me 6%. Why are you at 7%? That'll be one of the first things we talk about when I come out.
Okay.
So if I give them more information now, I'll be better prepared for that appointment.
Okay.
Versus being blindsided by it while I get there.
Yeah.
And then when I get there, and oh, by the way, it's very rare that you'll see a listing on our board under 100,000 for less than 7%. That's our rule. We put a lot of time, energy, and money into taking listings and getting them sold. We're 7% on anything 100,000. And we get it all the time. Why do we get it? Because we ask, right? I mean, you know, and then we offer out 3 and keep 4.
I like that.
Questions?
I want that.
Questions on the listing presentation, any part of it at all? So what you missed, I guess if we were to show that whole thing, okay, first of all, my presentations don't go that long. That actual video from start to finish is like an hour long, okay? My presentations on average are about 20 to 25 minutes. I, of course, dug deeper on every single thing I did just for the sake of the video so I could get all the scripts out, okay? So that even that pricing discussion, I would say I use half of those scripts on any given situation. But still, that was a 20 or 25 minute video, that takes it down to 12 minutes. We're still having a 10 to 15 minute conversation just on price, okay? but I'm going right through from the beginning of introducing myself, shaking their hand, taking a look around and going right into the table. When we get back to the table, I'm finding out their needs, their wants, their goals, what they're looking to accomplish. It's all about them for a good 5-10 minutes, you know, where they're going, why they're going there, all that good stuff. And then I say, okay, great, let's see what we can do to put a plan together to get this home sold. And then we go right into pricing, which you saw. And then after pricing, if I have to, we go through the plan of action, which is explaining step by step what we're going to do to sell the house. And then, of course, at that point, you know, asking for the business, which is, do you feel I can sell your home? Are you ready to put me to work for you today? You know, those types of questions. So that's the kind of the bookend of the presentation. But the reason why I wanted to show you this video is because, and I know I'm sounding repetitive here, without question, the pricing discussion is the most important part of the presentation. There's no other part that's more important than that discussion. Listings are gained and lost on that discussion. Questions? Yes?
You can't find a house. It's kind of hard.
Well,
then
you don't call them comps. I mean, you basically, you look at, okay, this, I had to go 10 miles out. I mean, it depends. If it's a rural area, for instance, hey, we had to go 15 miles out to find this one. And in most cases, if someone's looking in a rural area, they're looking like 20 or 30 or 40 minutes north. They're looking 20 or 30 or 40 minutes west. So you'll find them. You just have to broaden the search a bit and pull in other cities. Mm-hmm. And appraisers do that too, by the way.
Yeah.
Just have to, at that point, be conscious of the school districts. What else? You got something for your next presentation. Good luck. Yeah, you got it, guys.
Yeah.
Okay.